Sanjeev Raman has joined. Please introduce him and welcome him.
Would you like to do the honors, sir?
No, you go ahead.
We have a commander also here.
Go ahead.
Thank you so much. So good evening, everybody. Another lovely session from NHRD Chennai chapter to you all. It's been a lovely evening out here at Chennai here. And we warmly welcome Commander Sanjeev Raman to NHRD's fold. It's been an honor to have you, sir, an esteemed speaker. And to introduce Commander, he has a very diverse background and an alumnus from NIT Suratkal, where he did his metallurgical engineering. He started his career with the Indian Navy as a commissioned officer. He later completed his master's program in mechanical engineering from IIT Kanpur and his post-graduation diploma program in management studies from Jannalal Bajaj Institute of Management Studies. Sir, are you still studying?
I have recently enrolled for my PhD program, so I'm still a learning person.
Wonderful, wonderful. A lovely student with us. During his 21 years of military career, we have to say that he has participated in three conflicts. And one thing we all can relate is he's a Kargil hero. And the battlefield scenario has taught him the importance of building trust, honesty, integrity, values, and most important of all, purpose in life. And with that, when he took his active retirement from active service, he has come into the corporate world and is working with a lot of corporates and setting things in perspective. So, Commander, we are very, very happy to have you with us. And we hope that this platform will be completely entertaining and enlightening and will throw open myriads of perspectives for people, which otherwise this topic is something that is not so common. So we welcome you and the floor is all yours.
Thank you very much, Anuradha. At the outset, I would first like to thank Mr. Mahesh for contacting me and inviting me to have a session on my book. This book was released by Director I.M. Indore on 18th of January, which also happened to be my father's birthday. And it was somewhere in between the COVID times when the book was released. So I'm extremely thankful to Mr. Mahesh for giving me this opportunity to interact with such wonderful HR professionals, because the book primarily deals with the entire HR values of the organization on which the foundation is built. So I suppose the current president, if I'm not mistaken, is Ms. Gangapriya Chakravarti. So if that is so, I would like to also extend my heartfelt thanks to the president and the entire member of the Chennai chapter. No. Having said that, when I was in Navy, there were different phases of our life, which we have seen. Right from 1990, when the LPG policy of the government started, which is the liberalization, privatization, and globalization of the Narasimha Rao government. And then suddenly I was also investing small time in stock market, and in 2000, suddenly we had a dot-com bust. And a lot of people lost money. I was wondering that, how come people are, manipulating the system to such a large extent. But certainly we do not learn from the mistakes. And then the internet age started to caught on. There was more and more transparency which started to come into the system. People learned more. But certainly we did not learn from our past mistakes. And then somewhere around 2008, we had this subprime crisis, which affected the entire world. And it was a very, very difficult situation. I, being in government service, was not affected to that extent, but I could see the pain of a lot of people reading various reports in newspapers that they have lost their entire life savings and so on and so forth. And it, during that time also, we had that various terrorist attack, including the Taj Mahal hotel burning. That time I was posted in Mumbai, and from my office I could see that hotel burning for the next 4 days, and gun battle rattling. And I used to wonder that, you know, what is happening in the outside corporate world. And after 2 years, I submitted, after 21 years of my service, I moved to the corporate world. And the experience which was there in the corporate world was way different, because everybody was starting, or everybody was talking about freedom, that they don't have any kind of freedom, or they want more freedom to do the work. But what I had learned in my military career is, you need discipline. If you have discipline, you get more freedom. Whereas people were becoming indisciplined and demanding freedom. Now, it may be a contradictory statement that discipline gives you freedom, but actually it does. If you actually realize that if you are disciplined about your work, you can complete your work, you can take on more work. If you're disciplined about your time, you have plenty of spare time with you. So whichever area you talk about, if you are disciplined in certain aspects and do not cross the parameters which has been set by the management, you are totally free to do whatever you can. But there was a contradiction which I found, that in the corporate world, people were not able to understand this. And for everything, there was a, you know, I would say, some kind of conflict, that nobody is giving them freedom, nobody is, you know, is bothered about them. But people have been talking about more about their rights, but not fulfilling their own responsibilities. So that is where the entire thought process started to emerge in my mind, that how is it that an organization like military, or maybe there are a couple of organizations already existing in the corporate, and the one which came to my mind was the Tata Group, because I belong to Jamshedpur and I've seen the Tata Group functioning. That how a military which has been there for maybe, you know, hundreds and hundreds of years can still win the trust and loyalty of the people, whereas in the corporate it is not so. Why people do not trust them? And over the period of time, the government has been giving a lot of financial freedom to military also. So you also exercise your financial powers, you also abide by certain regulations, and still you have to work within certain parameters and deliver. And whatever you are doing, it may be at times not very good as far as the general public is concerned, but still you have been able to win the trust of the people, and people look up to you in times of crisis. So what is the difference which is existing between these two? And that set me thinking that how can I think that what the alignment between what I have learned and what I'm experiencing in the corporate world, can I bridge that gap and put it in a more structured way, what exactly a corporate should function? And there are a couple of corporates whom I have seen very closely, and they function like that, and they have survived all kinds of crises. So with that thought in mind, I started to jot down I started to prepare my notes. And it almost took me more than 3 years to really structure the way I would like it to go about it. And basically, I realized that any organization needs to have its very strong philosophy or the thought process on which the organization foundation is built. So if I'm talking about military, the military always derives its strength from what we call as the national aim. And what is the national aim of the country? The national aim comes from the economic development and the socio-political development of its citizen. That is the national aim. And based on the national aim, people decide what is in the interest of this organization or the country which would fulfill the national aim. That is, national aim, you can say, is what we call in the corporate the purpose of the organization for which it exists. And that interest of the country is defined in the preamble, where you talk about the feudal, you know, federal setup, fraternity, equality, justice, and all kinds of things. And based on that, your policy plans and everything is evolved. Now, Navy, I don't think so, has got, you know, that kind of vision statement that 20 years down the line, we will be controlling the globe and things like that. Nor do 30, 40 years back, the corporates had a mission or a vision statement and things like that. Their only purpose was, how do you, you know, increase the value for the shareholders? But that concept of shareholders was never existing as far as the military is concerned. It's always the stakeholders. So I decided to think that what is the foundation, what should be the foundation of the organization? And that foundation has to be its value system, its culture, its thought process. And I wanted to give it a particular name, a very Indian name for this entire concept. And I defined it as what we every day, when we talk about, we express with each other, we say, what is your vichar? What is your thought process? So that is the vichar of the organization, the thought process, the values and cultures of the organization, which lays the foundation for the organization. Unless and until is organization is very, very conscious about its thought process and philosophy and its culture, you would not be able to, you know, translate that into action or behavior of its people. And that is why from the value system and the foundation or the thought process comes the next aspect, what we call as think, act. How the way you think, the same way you act. And that is the behavior of the people. And that from that, I decided that I should also give a very Indianness to this concept. And I decided to name it as Achar. Achar in means, what is your behavior? How do you behave? And how your employees, your people, how they behave within the organization? How do they interact with the people outside? How do they interact with the team within the organization, with the customers, with so many stakeholders who are involved in your organization? It need not be restricted to you per se. How you interact with your subordinates, with your superiors, it has got a very wider spectrum. So your thought process, the way you think, the same way you act. And whatever you are doing, if it remains within the nutshell of the organization, then it cannot win the trust of the people. The military does it because they go and win the trust of the people. They go to the community, work for the community. You know, they propagate their entire culture and values to the people or to the area where they actually operate. And that is how they win the heart and minds of the people. They understand the difficulties of the terrain, the environment in which they have to operate. And that is the concept which the organization needs to take it forward. Any corporate organization, that means it needs to propagate its thought process, its values, its culture, and take it to the people. See, this is what I am. You need to trust me. If you are putting your money in my organization, be rest assured nothing is going to happen and you will get it back maybe multiple times more. If you are giving me land, you will get, you know, if I'm taking the entire jungle, whenever I use it, I will recreate a better place, a better jungle in future for the next generation to live. So there will be not of that resistance would go. So unless and until your organization thought process is taken to the community, to the society, then only you will be able to win the trust. And that came to the concept of, again, giving a little more Indianness to that concept. I said it has to be prachar. So vichar, achar, and prachar, that VAP, that should translate into an organization thought process which I call it as a value-aided progression, which is also VAP. If you are adding value to whatever you are doing, not value in monetary terms, but in terms of winning the trust of the people, in winning their hearts, and ensuring the sustainability of the organization, then you would be, in the long term, you will ensure that your next generation would be able to, you know, take your vision and thought process to much greater heights. So that was the entire concept based on which I wrote that, I wrote this book, and I titled it as Morality of Profits, primarily because whenever we were discussing in the corporate, or I used to meet my friends, every time they used to say that profit is a bad word. No, profit is not at all a bad word, because without money, no organization can sustain, whether it is a family or an NGO or a corporate or a government or military, anybody, everybody needs money. But it is important not that how much you earn, but how you earn. That is the aspect which has now started to build in the corporate setup over a period of time. And when I was writing that book, I would, that was sometime in August 2009, I read an article in the CNBC, in which some 200 major US companies, they had talked about what should be the purpose of that organization. So now we are talking the multinationals of United States, the biggest economy, the biggest drivers of world economy, they are deciding what should be the purpose of the organization, which from the military parlance was very, very clear to us. This is the national aim, this is the objective, this is how we have to go about it. And what did they said in that statement which they issued? I would like to read it out from a extract from my book where I have quoted that. They said the purpose, a new definition of the purpose of the organization was issued, wherein the purpose is no longer considered to be of maximizing profits or to serve the shareholders' interest. Instead, investing in employees, delivering value to customers, dealing ethically with suppliers, and supporting external communities are the new goals of these US corporations. There is no talking about, you know, shareholders or making a lot of profit at this. How is it that people have started to realize that? And that is why this aspect of the morality of profit and to, you know, link it to a value-added progression needs to be transmitted in a much more better and possibly in a simpler way where people can understand. And that is why I have written this book with various anecdotes from various areas, including corporates, military, mythology. You can talk about, you know, every area. You pick a page, you will find an anecdote which would describe the kind of things which is required to be done. So that is the entire crux of the book. And with this, I would request if Anuradha, we can have, if you have got something more to add, and maybe we can subsequently see.
Thank you so much, Commander. It was a lovely introduction, and I think you have in fact summarized your entire book. But one thing as a reader, I will have to say is definitely this is a much, much more easy in a very anecdote based book that throws upon myriads of topics that were once upon a time considered as moral etiquettes, moral ethics for everybody to live on. Sadly, those are all forgotten words today, and seeing that explained in simple terms that apply to everyday business is indeed a big change. So we do have quite a lot of questions. So if we may proceed with that, and then we can throw the floor open for everybody here.
Yes, certainly.
So yes, indeed, you very clearly explained what was your motivation behind writing the book. To quote you from one of your excerpts, culture is the immune system of business, is what you have written. Now, in recent times, we would like to know if you have come across any company where the culture has managed to save the day for the company, maybe even from going into oblivion.
Well, the very first company which comes to my mind is Tata Steel. And I'm talking about not now. I will be telling a story maybe of early 80s. So I'm talking 35 years back. No, see, Tata Jamshedpur as a city doesn't have a municipality. You know, there are areas which is controlled by the Tata Group, and the township is owned by Tata Group. And there are areas which are outside its control where you have got a municipality. And in the 80s, the condition of the municipality was not very, very good. And suddenly, and that was the time of erstwhile Bihar, and then the government, Lalu government was there, they decided to take over the entire land and create and do a municipality and bring it under a municipality. You will be very, very surprised. The entire citizens of Jamshedpur had filed a petition in the Supreme Court that they don't want municipality. They trust Tata so much. They believe that Tata would deliver better results than the government taking over, and whatever the good has been done by the Tata Steel, everything will get eroded. Because in early 80s, I used to see that road sweeping machine that used to sweep the road at night. We had a sewage treatment plant which used to produce potable water, but because of the stigma, people were not able to drink it. So it was used for gardening and other purposes. So if that was the culture and the value system of the Tata Group, I would say not particularly Tata Steel, for which people stood by, they did not have to do anything. The entire community stood by and said, no, we don't want it. Please, we are standing not by the government, they were standing by a company. And the company, they were standing because they had believed that company. They believed in the values of that company. They believed in the culture of that company. And even now, when the COVID happened, that same company, it stood for their community. You, in the entire COVID period, it's still making steals. It's still making, there was never a statement from MD or the vice president of steel process or iron making process or anything. The CSR head, he was running the show. He was the face of the company. Every activity of Tata Steel was represented by the chief of corporate social responsibility, that chief. He was the face of the company. And then and now, if I see the advertisement of Tata Steel then, when we were possibly had started my career, it used to say after the entire advertisement, it used to say, we also make steel. And today it has translated to read, we also make tomorrow. It doesn't talk about we are making steel or anything or like that. So its philosophy, its values, people here have imbibed and they see a reflection of their values or their culture in their life. It has impacted them very, very in a positive way. I have also been a beneficiary of that. And to say the least, one company, if you are asking, certainly the Tata Group as a whole. That is a very living example, and a couple of examples I have mentioned about the company in my book also.
Well, I guess I did read quite a lot of examples from the Tata Group throughout the book. So I guess the impact is very much there in what you have experienced in your life. Well, can you please provide a bridge to current business scenario and the triple filter test that you have mentioned?
Well, you see, the triple filter test, which I talked about in my book about that Socrates triple filter test, is it the truth, whether it is beneficial and things like that. I don't think so. There can be a simple triple filter test, which can be universally applied to all the corporates, because every corporate has its own set of values, own set of cultures. no two organizations will have the same thing, and it will never, it can never have. Say, for example, if you're talking about a family as an organization, I'm not even talking about corporate, any organization, family, if a family values education and they say that, yes, education is very, very important, their triple filter test would be decided based on that. Then whatever is required to ensure that the children gets proper education, good education, study in the best schools, they will do that. Whether it requires taking loans, asking people for money, certainly they will do that. So their filter test would be designed as per that. And if another family feels that, yes, my son, my daughter should start to quickly earn money and start to support the family. I have got a shop, I cannot run on my own. I want my son to immediately come and help me out. So his triple filter test would be very, very different. He would start to focus not on education, but on some other parameters, because his values have changed to some other areas. Whereas for somebody else, a value system is different. I can say honesty and transparency is a value. Somebody may say, no, I want more creativity and value. Somebody may say, talk about integrity. So, whatever you are defining, based on what value system you want your people to imbibe, your triple filter test needs to be decided or formulated as per the values which you want your employees or your company to be associated with. It has to be done like that. I don't think so there will be a universal triple filter test. And I've given one example of Rotary in my book. When we go, we take an oath. It's a four-way test, we say. In Rotary, I'm a part of the Rotary, and every day, every meeting, that four-way test is read out. Is it the truth? Is it beneficial to all concerned? Will it bring friendship and harmony? And visit will be beneficial. That's a four-way test. And let me tell you, during the process when I was writing that book, I could never imagine that Rotary Trust Foundation would remove its chair, Rotary chair. The person who is heading the Global Rotary Trust Foundation, he was removed from his post because his actions did not follow the that four-way test. So I think every organization needs to decide on its own. There cannot be a universal triple filter test.
Thank you so much. The next question I would like to give it as the cognitive dissonance between ethics and values that we speak of, and the cost of doing business here in India is quite high. And how can you still justify the need for ethics in business, keeping this in mind?
Is it very costly? I don't think so. If you there are hundreds of examples daily we see in newspapers, right from Nirav Modi to PNB Bank scam to so many scams. So the cost which you are incurring on imbibing these ethical values, I don't think so. It is very minuscule compared to the loss of people's faith and trust in that organization. You are paying a very small price. Only thing is that such things cannot be developed overnight. Now, it requires a very kind of rigorous and continuous process. It's a very, very long drawn process. You cannot say that from tomorrow onwards, you have to do this and people will start to behave like that. It will never happen. So whenever we are talking about ethics and values, you cannot quantify in immediate monetary terms as far as cost is concerned, but certainly its repercussion would be felt much later, because one small action, one action by one employee will bring down your company tumbling down. And the best example which, out of the blue, it came to my mind was Satyam. The name of the company is Satyam. The owner is Ramalingam Raju, and his own actions brought down the company. He could not hide it. So is it very costly? I don't think so. It is not. If you don't do it, it is costly, because what you have done over a period of time, it is lost without, it can go away in seconds. So certainly it is not a costly affair. Only thing is that it needs to be nurtured very, very carefully.
Absolutely. While on that topic of cost, I guess you have quoted cost is more important than quality, but quality is the best way to reduce cost. Now, can you please give us a life example for this? What inspired you to write this line?
Okay. I think that's a word from the Japanese Mr. Genushi, if I recall correctly. The best way to bring down cost is quality. I'll give you two examples, not one. And both very recent ones. We have this, Boeing 737 MAX. The Boeing, Air India had bought some 70 planes of that. And there was a technical hitch in that plane. And because of which, world over, the airlines decided to ground that plane. What was technical hitch? What could be the Dreamliner? Boeing 737 Dreamliner. It used to be called Dreamliner. Okay. The Dreamliner plane got grounded. So you may bring down the cost, but the best way to bring down the cost is to improve quality. The other very, very live example, which very recently happened, maybe 2 years back, and I'm talking about global companies. Boeing is a global company. BMW with a company called Taraka, which used to make airbags. There was a class suit, where they said that when the airbag opens, many times it bursts, and because of which it injures the passengers. And there was a class suit due to which the company, the directors were also implicated. And it was till 2019, it even affected the 6 series BMW. So you are talking about the impact on the entire branding of that company, BMW 6 series, right from 3 to 6 series everywhere. Then the cost of recalling that thing, the entire product. One product quality which gets affected, it is not just about the quality or the defect in that product, but you are losing the entire effort which you had earlier incurred, or the cost which you had earlier incurred in the process, in the production process, the manpower which you have used, the earlier global supply chain which you have created to get that product. So all those costs are also involved, which has suddenly become zero. And it has impacted your brand image value. So certainly, quality, in fact, I was reading in one of the book, I don't recall, that sometime in the 80s, when quality was more focus of Japanese people, Six Sigma had not taken up to that extent. And one of the Japanese auto company had requested one US company had requested a Japanese company to make certain parts with a restriction that maybe 20 or 30 parts per million can only be defective parts. So when they received their entire package, there was a small package separately delivered, and it was written that these are my defective parts, 20 which you had asked for, because we don't believe in making any defective parts. So we have specifically made it for you. So that is the concept of quality which they imbibed. Because they know the importance, the impact it will have in the brand image of the company, which is definitely much more valued. And that is why that particular line is written, and it has been taken from the Japanese gentleman, because it originated with his thought process.
I think we hear what you are telling. Every step and every action that you're talking is more in terms of a long-term rather than a short-term perspective.
Yes, yes. It is always a long-term, because whenever you are looking for any organization you are talking, it's a continuous process. We talk about an organization, it's a continuing system. I am starting an organization, my balance sheet tomorrow is closed. That doesn't mean my company is closed. It's a continuing entity, if that is the correct financial term. It's a continuing entity. So when you are talking about a continuing entity, you are looking at 10 years, 15 years, 20 years down the line, where it will be. So you have to look from that perspective only. You cannot look that today it is like that.
Serve Qual. I guess our audience will be interested to know more about it.
Well, Serqual, see, this is, although I have mentioned very briefly in my book about this concept, maybe a couple of lines only, but this was more related to service industry. See, whenever you're talking about a product quality, so there are certain parameters which is available to you to check a product quality. Certain testing is done. Certain procedures are followed, whether it is material testing or certification by an external agency. But in a service sector, where there is a lot of subjectivity, there is a lot of perception. So whenever you go to a service industry, how do you expect what is the value of your service which you are intending to deliver? And what is the value which is perceived by the customer for which he is willing to pay? So these are two different aspects. From the service point of view, this was a concept which was which was developed by Velleric and Parasuram Leonard Berry. And primarily, it talked about five parameters. And those five parameters, it is in the normal sense, it is also called rater model, RATER, rater model. Okay, so the rater model talked about reliability as first parameter, R, then assurance as the second parameter. T is stands for tangible, E for empathy, and R for responsibility. So these were the five parameters on which they developed this entire model, for which you can do an evaluation of the entire market processes from the customer point of view. So when you are talking like that, each of these parameters would vary depending upon which sector you are trying to target. Say for a medical, when you talk about a medical or a hospital sector, empathy has got a higher value than possibly any other factor, because you are talking about human lives. So this entire model was structured in a way where all the aspects of or the market synergy was broken down into certain parameters. So if for a medical it is empathy, maybe for banking or financial sector, it is more related to assurance. That means you are talking the person with whom you are interacting. Does he have the knowledge of the product, and can he instill certain sense of pride, or I would say trust and confidence in you? Only then you would like to invest in that product, because it involves money. He is not talking about empathy. So maybe assurance becomes more important as a factor when you think that what is the value which a customer is willing to pay, or what he perceives that as a value. So for these are the different parameters on which, if you talk about tangibles talk about the kind of equipment, the kind of facilities, the kind of people all put together. So it is more relevant to a hotel industry. If you go to a reception, you go and check a room, what kind of bed it is there, what kind of equipments, what kind of surroundings it is there. So that has got a more value, because then you are physically seeing. Many times you go to a hotel and say, I would like to see a room also, how it is, how good it is. Then you come back and yes, okay, take care. So there are different parameters on which it was broken down. And that rater model was considered, and I think still considered, as one of the best models for service industries, I would say, quality assessment. For manufacturing, a quality assessment is totally different, but from a service industry point of view, in fact, when they had started with that, they had analyzed some maybe 97 parameters and subsequently brought down to these five, and all these five have got some 20 or 20, 22 or 25 questionnaires based on which it is distributed and you get a feedback. So that is the kind of cervical or the rater model which is relevant for the service industry.
Thank you, sir. Now I'm reading out a quote again from your book. What do you do to seek expert advice? For which you have replied, I talk to myself. Now, this is very intriguing to read, but one doubt that comes to our mind is, more often than not, value system we do say is highly corrupted in individuals today. Now, wherever we find such situations, what sort of a decision are we expecting out of the value system, number one, or the ethics system that is corrupted? And from within, when such a decision comes, what is the moral standing for such a decision?
Okay. I think this is a very, very good and very relevant question, because the entire thing starts from individual. One, if I am good, then only I can make my family good, my surroundings good, and then talk about township and other thing. Everything starts, emanates from me. You see, every organization, when you're talking about an organization, the values and culture needs to be, you know, very, very well defined and regularly, you know, fine-tuned based on the changing societal values. So maybe what was relevant 20 or 30 years back in today's internet age is no more be relevant. So that also I need to keep a check, and I have to keep remove every time. What do you do? Let me ask, what do you do if you fall ill? Then you go to a doctor. Possibly he will prescribe certain tests and he will say that, you know, you have, after doing all kinds of tests, you have got this particular problem. But when he comes to an individual, when you're talking about the individual thinking process, what is the best prescription to refine yourself? And the best prescription is introspection. That is your diagnostic tool by which you analyze your thought process, your action. So unless and until you prepare your mind internally to accept certain things, even if I have a negative value and I am interacting with, different people, and I need to feel that, yes, these are certain things which I should somehow imbibe, I am not able to do it. I need to do a self-introspection, and for which I need to talk to myself. Unless and until I talk to myself and I convince myself, only then I will be able to accept it and, you know, move further. One of the aspects which related to this, I have written in my book, is, which was mentioned by Swami Vivekananda. He said that rain drops from the sky. If it falls on a hot surface, it evaporates. If it falls in a gutter, you cannot do anything about it. You cannot even wash your feet. If you take it in your hand, you can take a sip, you can drink. If it falls in a petal, it will shine like a pearl. But if it falls in an oyster, it will become pearl. So the drop of rain is same. Where it gets associated, that is what it becomes. If my association with some good people or some bad people happens in my life, where to choose, how to choose, can only be decided by me. And for that, I need to do self-introspection. For that, I need to talk to myself. Unless and until I convince myself, I will not be able to take the right step in the right direction. So that is why I say that you need to, decide constantly. If unless and until you constantly keep telling you yourself, this is the right thing to do, this is the right thing, then only your behavior, your thought process, your actions will start to follow a certain pattern. If you don't do it, listen to people and forget about it, it will never happen. So that is the main context in which I have mentioned that you need to talk to yourself.
Thank you. One doubt we did have while coming across is, you have spoken of son of control and son of apprehension.
Yes.
May we hear a little more about it from you?
Okay, this is a very, very, I am very happy that you asked me this question. And I don't have any presentation. So I would take out, I would show it possibly from the book. Is it visible?
We are having the shadow of the.
Okay. Let me put it in a different way. What happens is, anybody who faces any kind of stress in life is because of his inability to manage self. That is the main source of all kinds of stress in life. You see, I can give you many examples from my personal life, both from the military as well as from the corporate. So let me give you an example from the corporate. I was suddenly moved I was into design and then marketing, corporate communication in a shipbuilding industry. And then suddenly I moved to construction, civil engineering. And I was handling projects of high-rise buildings, roads, and all those kind of things. And one day, the CEO of my company, he said that, I want you to take over this project of high-rise building. So I went there. Why? Because the earlier gentleman was not able to handle it because there was a lot of payment issues, money not coming on time, and he was not able to handle the vendor, and there was a lot of problems at site. And when I landed, within very short time, one day, Mr. Narendra Modi came on television and said, demonetization. So everything vanished. What all little cash I had to manage the site, everything went away. So without cash, you cannot manage the construction site because you have got daily vendor payments, you have to run your BES, you have got so many issues which requires cash dealing on a daily basis in a construction site. I really didn't know what to do because people used to come with guns also and threaten me that if you don't do this, then we will harm you and things like that. But unless and until you have the ability to control yourself, manage yourself, then if you don't have that ability, you cannot manage the people who are coming to you. You cannot manage your team. So basically, you have got two sons, which I've said, the son of concern and the son of control. See, the inner son is your own, I would say that you have got an inner circle. That is your own self, your son of, your own son on which you have got your influence. And then there is an outer son, which is deals with the external environment. The gap between these two son is your area of concern. Now, there are so many situations which will keep happening in your life, whether personal life or in corporate life, on which you have got no control. And that is which will affect your external son. Let me see if I can get that picture. That would be best, very, very good to explain it to you. I don't know. It's a very... I think it is.
Can I show it from my video if you don't mind?
Huh? Yes. I don't think so. There is a lot of shadow. So basically, I'm talking about the son of control and the son of apprehension. The bigger son is your son of apprehension. That can happen. The apprehensions can come from any area. The government suddenly decides to impose some tax from retrospective effect. You have got no control. Suddenly a riot happens. Suddenly a supply chain, COVID has happened. You have got no control on that external environment. That is your outer son of apprehension. That is your outer son of apprehension. And you have got an inner son, which is your son of control. And between the two gap is your area of concern. Now, if the outer son increases because of all the external environment, that area of concern, the gap widens. If that gap widens, your inability, your stress level increases. And you are not able to manage yourself. Because there is no way by which you can control that external environment. It will keep happening by some way or the other. Today, farmer strike has happened. Roads are blocked. You want to take your people to hospital also. You cannot take it. Again, your stress level has increased because your external environment, suddenly that gap has increased. So how do you bridge that gap? The gap between the external and the internal. That is the son of concern and the son of control and the son of apprehension. You can only cover that gap if you also proportionately increase your son of control. If you make your son of control bigger, the gap between the outer and the inner son would reduce. So how do you make that bigger? That is your technique of self-management. And that deals with your belief system, your values, your trust, the kind of culture. If you are able to increase that sort of control and make it much bigger, you would be certainly finding that you are at much ease. This external environment is affecting you much less. Although it will still trouble you, but it will affect you much less. But if it shrinks, you are not able to control your own self. Your son of control will further shrink only. It itself will increase your area of concern. So that is the reason, that is the main concept which I have talked about in the self-management part of that book. Because the behavior, when I'm talking about the achar, the behavior of the people, in my book have dealt with two particular aspects. One is about the self-management, and the second is about the money management. And both the aspects, you need to have that. And that is what it deals, as I said, the son of control or the son of apprehension. And that is the area of concern in between.
Thank you so much. One more question we have. How do you differentiate proficiency and efficiency from your perspective?
Well, When I decide to apply for any kind of job or any work, people see your credentials, where I worked, what is my background, do I have the necessary skills, qualifications, and things like that. And based on that, you qualify yourself for a particular job. So that is your first step towards, a delivery process. And that qualifies as your ability to deliver. Your proficiency is always your ability to deliver. But when you land up in a particular situation, I moved from corporate, from military to corporate, they say that, yes, you have got all these backgrounds, please come and join. But when I joined a company, I found that, yes, the situation is very, very different. In spite of all my qualifications, all my skills, I'm not able to deliver. That delivery component comes from various other aspects. And it comes from the skills, the team, the soft skills, the competency I build into it, the kind of desire, the motivation I have to, work within their existing framework and not get bogged down with my previous things organizations, you know, backlog or what do you carry your backlog of the previous organization? I had that freedom. I'm not getting here. So I am not able to deliver. I had so-and-so gentleman who is to help me out here. Nobody is helping me out. So that can, your ability to deliver depends upon whole lot of other things. And whenever you write your, you know, achievements, it is always talk about what is your achievements. Your achievement is never based on your proficiency. It is always based on what you have delivered in that particular organization. Your proficiency may qualify you for a job, but your actual delivery on the ground will decide upon how you take or how you move ahead in that particular organization. And that is your efficiency. So from proficiency to efficiency, if you have to move, you need to have a lot of parameters related to soft skills, to your self-management skills, to imbibing the organization values and cultures, drop your, you know, bags which you are carrying from your previous organizations, you know, a whole lot of other things will come into play when you are talking from proficiency to efficiency. That is the thing which I wanted to say. That is how I make that distinction.
Well, I do have one last question before we throw the floor open to the participants. We have heard from many speakers and folks that in the military, you survive only by following orders blindly. Now, in the corporate world, we really don't have that luxury always. Sometimes, may I request people to mute themselves? Thank you. So, in the corporate world, sometimes we do have to overcome that and take things on our hands in order to do the best for the organization. Like, having said that, how do you ensure that the military leadership model that you have proposed, how can that be a sustainable one in the corporate world?
See, if you think from management perspective, most of the management philosophies and principles have emanated from military. But military follows a different set of parameters that same cannot be applied to corporate. Although the ethos, the culture might emanate in the similar way, but it needs to be toned down. I see. When you say you always follow orders, no, it doesn't work like that in military also. Whenever if you see in fact, many of you might not have, their family members might not be a military person, but whenever you see any of the movies in military, the recent one being, you know, Uri Attack or Shenshah or things like that, you imagine the kind of planning, the kind of detailing which people go through. Every activity is very, very, very meticulously planned. If you have got the slightest of doubt, that is the time you should raise it. You cannot raise that doubt when you are on field and saying, sir, I don't have this. I'm sorry, I did not get this. I forgot to ask you this. How do I do it now? That is not the time. Then it is left to your ingenuity, your creativity, how you manage that situation. And that is the ability of self-management. Improvise and do. So military doesn't follow only orders. They follow a different set of process where they examine every aspect. And in that military aspect, one of the most important thing is stealth. Your ability to strike without other people knowing it. And I think that is the strategy of the corporate also. The marketing people, if you want to launch a product, your first is stealth. You do not want your product details to be out at the market. Your competitor should not know. Here also it is the same thing. Only thing is that once you have decided, thereafter launching of the operation, you can never question. You have to follow orders means you have to follow orders. If you cannot follow orders, do whatever you feel like. That decision is entirely left to that particular individual. You cannot fall back and call back and say, I cannot do this now because so-and-so gentleman is talking about this. I'll give you one very relevant example. We had lot of issues or a lot of debate about that gentleman, Major Gogoi, who had tired one stone pelter to his jeep in Kashmir during election time. Okay. And there was a lot of human rights people taking up that issue and saying that what he did was wrong. His job was what? His job was to conduct the election, ensure that nobody is hurt, nobody is killed. And you should be able to do that election in a very fair way. Your job is not to protect people. Now in that situation, if the stone pelter is there, do you suggest that he should call up and say that, I would, what do I do? There are people, how do I handle the situation? Whatever best in that situation, because he's the one who is sticking his neck out in that situation. If he has to improvise and ensure that the job is fulfilled or done in a particular way, he does it. By hook or by crook, there is no questioning of not doing it. Either you do it, in the process get killed, accept it. Nobody will ask questions. But you cannot come back and say, I have not done it for X, Y, Z reason. That is not acceptable. You have done it in the process, whatever required, you have fulfilled that job. That may be acceptable and you can give your justification later on. So when you say you follow the order to the T, that doesn't mean that you don't plan for it. But eventualities will happen. And when eventualities will happen, there is no question of going back and asking anything. You take your own decisions. And that decision is left to you. So I think it is what is happening in military is very well happening in corporate, because most of the things they manage from the military only. But yes, it needs to be toned down in a different way. You cannot follow that kind of, to the T what military does. Otherwise, every organization will start to crumble and people will become very, very autocratic. So I don't believe that to that extent corporate should follow.
I guess that is a different perspective altogether, because we were under the impression that yes, you do follow, but I think you're putting it right, saying that the planning needs to be much, much more, and you ask all your doubts in the planning and then while execution, just do it. So that brings it very much into relevance, and thank you so much. Can we now throw the floor open for the audience?
Sure, why not?
To take questions. Hi all, please do ask your questions. You can unmute yourself and ask. If not, you are also free to write your question in chat and we will ask it on your behalf.
Commodore, can I ask a question, Anuradha? This is DLN ready.
Hello, sir. Good evening. And please do ask your question.
Good evening. Commodore, in army selections, take first? Either proficiency or efficiency?
Well, sir, army selection is because when you are selecting, you really do not know what is happening. In fact, I would say the way army is selecting, to a large extent, many of the corporates have started to imbibe that process. Army selection is done by three different parameters. Okay, you do not only see, you don't get very, very academically very sound people who are scoring 90% and all. No. So there are three different type of people who do your selection process. One is called a GTO, which is the group task officer. It gives you different type of situations to handle. And it is spread over 5 days. It is not a half an hour of or 40 minutes interview. It is spread over 5 days. In that 5 days, they see how you behave. What is your, how you conduct yourself also. So the GTO gives you certain group tasks where you are supposed to be the leader, as well as certain tasks in which you are supposed to be one of the members, apart from all the physical activities. So he assesses you for various other parameters of skills like team building, your oratory skills and things like that. Then there is another gentleman who assesses you for your psychological, skills, how you react to a situation. And he conducts another set of tests over a period of 5 days. And the third is a gentleman who is the president of that committee, and he does a personal interview, one-to-one interview. So when you do this entire thing, then you decide over a period of 5 days, and all three gentlemen have to clear you individually. Even if one gentleman says, no, he's not fit, you are not selected. Now, if I see that, if I have to imbibe that kind of culture and values which organization is looking at, and it is being assessed by a different set of people, how do I see that to some extent corporates have started like that? Earlier, I don't think so. There was maybe 20 years, 25 years back, 30 years back, there was no concept of internship, that you go do an internship for 2 years, 2 months in any company. Then you see what is the culture of that company. A lot of people give you feedback about that intern, how he has behaved, whether he may be a high ranker. He may be the best in his class as far as education and other things are concerned. But is he a fit in this particular organization? If he's not a fit, then possibly you may not get back to the same organization with a good job. One incident which I have mentioned in my book about the recruitment process and linked it to the corporate is about that Taj Mahal Hotel incident. Now, when that incident happened, sir, there were some 1,600 guests in that hotel. And out of those 1,700, and out of those 1,700, 1,600 were hotel staff. Everybody was rescued, and I think three people died. And all the three people were hotel staff. No guest was ever, received any kind of injury, maybe minor and all. So then people started to wonder, how come the hotel staff who knew all entry exit point decided not to leave that hotel during the terrorist attack? So it came down to how do they recruit those people, the frontline staff, the senior people, and all those people who are managing the various affairs is one thing, but the frontline staff, the reception, the kitchen, and all these people, from where do they recruit? They have found out they don't recruit the toppers. They always recruit people, do a background check about how they behave in society. What is the kind of respect they have shown to teachers, to elders, and things like that. And that became the very basis because of which no hotel staff ever left that particular hotel during that incident. So they were taught that you have to be the ambassadors of the guest and not the ambassadors of the hotel. Your priority is about guest. The same thing comes as far as military is concerned. No, in a corporate, whenever we talk, we say if a corporate is improved or it starts to do much better, then the employee is saved. He will get his promotions and things like that. So your focus is on improving the organization. Whereas in the military, the same aspect which I talked about, the Taj Mahal Hotel incident, the military, the focus is on the people. If the people is improved, the organization is saved. If you train the people in a way that he behaves in a particular way, certainly it will bring much more goodwill to the organization. That is what happened with the Taj Mahal Hotel. And that is what I think most of the organization have started to do. You call them, put them for an internship. You give them some projects to do, some assignments, and ask them to coordinate with certain set of people of different departments. How well you have coordinated that project, based on that recruitment process happens. So I think there is some bit of synergy which is happening in the military as well as corporate. And the corporates are trying to imbibe or taking a lot of things which has already been proven in the military world. I would put it that way. I hope I have answered your questions.
Yes, indeed. Thank you so much, because that was indeed quite illuminating, talking about the recruitment process and talking about proficiency and efficiency. Thank you so much, sir. Can we ask another participant to shoot out your question?
Hello.
Hi, good evening.
I have a question. We were talking about people recruitment, proficiency, efficiency, and commander will be the right person because he has military experience and he worked in shipbuilding, engineering, construction. Now he's the author. Now, the main problem what we face is recruitment or hiring talents and retaining next. So what is your viewpoint in selecting a candidate or choosing a candidate who has these different industry or profile? What is your recommendation to the industry, especially for the people who are 40 years past?
Well, I really can't comment on that, but I can share my experience. What people look for, they certainly must be looking for certain things. You see, when I went for my interview with a shipbuilding company, which was in Calcutta, Garden Beach Shipbuilders, in my 21 years of career in military, I had never worked in design. Never. Not even one day. I'd always been either on ship or in the production floor, in production planning, maybe on staff doing operations planning, or direct on board ship as the chief engineer deployed on ship, but never worked at design. And I had applied for 3 jobs because in being an engineer, you're 70 to 80% of the work goes towards logistics and materials planning also. So I had applied for materials and design. And I think planning work, 3 areas. They shortlisted me for planning, shortlisted me for design. I don't know what they found in that interview, which I had with them, because they, they asked me one specific question. They said that you don't have any background of design, and when you have come for design interview, why should we select you for design? I only had to tell him one thing. He said, I have worked in as a trial officer, and all the ships, new induct ships, which comes to Indian Navy, I conduct that trial. And I do the performance assessment of all the engines, the main turbines, the main propulsion, as well as power generation. And I found that in one of the trials, your gas turbine intake temperature was shooting very, very high. So I realized during my assessment that your gas turbine air intake is positioned very close to its exhaust. So when it is sucking that air, it is sucking maybe part of the exhaust. And that is how the air intake temperature was becoming high. It is not the normal atmospheric air it is sucking. It is sucking certain other high temperature air also. So whenever you are doing a design, your people who have done the entire design, they don't have ship experience. I have the ship experience. I have handled ship. I have operated ships. So I know from the practical point of view, what are the problems which can come when you are having your entire layout plan, how you are doing the selection of the machinery. Some people may do all the calculations and find the horsepower is right, but whether that horsepower, if you are positioning it correctly, that engine, so that you have enough people to do the maintenance and other thing, who is going to give you that input? That input I can give, because I might not have operated, done the designing, but I have operated. So possibly they might have selected me for that. And similar situation, I don't know. When I went for my civil engineering, that infrastructure company interview, they asked me a whole lot of questions, certainly not on civil engineering, because I was not a civil engineer. And I told them, you see, I'm not a civil engineer. The very first comforting words came from the deputy CEO of that company. He said, I am not a civil engineer also. I am a chemist. And the founder of the company is a chemical engineer. He's not a civil engineer. So you don't worry about all those aspects. No, Let us analyze you what you can do. And let me tell you, wherever there has been a crisis in that company, all crisis areas where people abandoned and did everything, the CEO of the company used to call me and say that I want you to handle that situation. So I do not really, I'm not a recruiter, so I would not be able to really comment on that. But people who do the recruitment, they must certainly be thinking of certain parameters on which, not based only on the education, qualification, and other things, maybe about his ability to handle situations. Because you know, any company, when you take, you have your own induction program. I was a metallurgical engineer when I joined the Navy, and there is no metallurgical process happening inside Navy. I did my M.Tech in mechanical, and I subsequently became a gas turbine expert and a vibrational analysis expert. So Navy, in all in-house, all corporates have their own in-house training programs wherein they keep training people for their own particular activity. But certainly they might be looking for certain things which will be of more value than just your degree. More value to the company as far as taking the organizations forward. Otherwise, I don't see any reason why Mr. N. Chandrasekharan, who is not an MBA or from IIM or from very, very hi-fi NIT and IITs, he is the chairman of the Tata Group and all kinds of IITs and IIMs and so many senior people have not made it to that post. So there has to be certain other qualities, just not your education and your high-flying marks which you to get. So the people who recruit, I'm not a recruiter, they must be focusing on certain parameters. And if given an opportunity, if I have to interact, I would throw about situations and find out how is his reaction. How handily would have handled any kind of situation. So maybe that is the, I would talk about the proficiency and efficiency and how do you look for talent in a particular person.
Well said, sir. Thank you very much.
We have a question from Devasmita Basu, who is asking, how do we implement our thought process re-engineering in the HR domain?
Well, I think to a very large extent, I have already covered it in my earlier, when Mr. I think Susai Raj, when he was also talking, the HR and the entire focus of my book has always been like that. So if you are talking, in fact, if you see at the end of every chapter of my book, I have given certain takeaways, certain bullet points, what you should do. And most of these deal with HR points only. So, and the HR should never only talk about, a sense of team building or team spirit and things like that. One of the very important aspects which people miss is money management. So if you say that money management should only be dealt with the finance and marketing people, and they should, I don't think so. During the training, certain aspects of money management in a very, very simplified way, if you start to talk about return on investment and return on equity and things like that, nobody would be interested. So this aspect generally I've seen is neglected whenever people talk about decision at all levels in decision making. If you talk to an assistant manager in a company, he's not interested in cash flow and margins and things like that. He's not even, it doesn't even strike his mind. He thinks that is the domain of possibly director of finance or the chairman of the company. They should deal with that kind of thing. So apart from your focus on values, the principles, the philosophies of the organizations, one other aspect which needs to be included is certain aspects of money management. And that is one aspect which very, very simply I have elucidated in my book. I have talked about the cash flow, the margin, the growth, the customer in a very, very different way, which any layman should be able to understand. If I teach my people that, yes, if this bill has to be submitted by so-and-so date, and if he doesn't do it, and the time period is 45 days, the credit timeline, if he's doing it 2 days earlier, he's ensuring that the company credit line is available 2 days before. If he's delaying it by 2 days, he is also ensuring that my credit line is not available for the another 48 hours. So every decision making, apart from the HR policies, the financial part must also be in a very subtle way explained it to them. And the second aspect is certainly that has been the focus of my book, and that is you need to develop a culture. The culture, whatever I am talking about, the culture is always organization culture is its vision statement. It should be a reflection of its vision statement. What do I see? How do I see my company 20 years down the line? That should be reflected. That is a reflection of the vision statement, and that should come in my culture. If my culture today is such that anybody, if I have got a group of people who are very, very, properly aligned with the culture, even if there are any external influences, somebody tries to manipulate me, even if I do it, there is an inherent resistance which will come, even if not from me, but so many other people. It is your ability to fight back any kind of wrong practices which is happening in the system. That is your immune system. So you need to focus and develop your immune system of the organization, and which is based on values, that culture of the organization. That has to be the focus area. As I say, the growth of any organization is the nervous system. The nervous system is what? Whatever you get from the five senses, based on the five senses, your body tends to react and prepares you for any kind of attack. If you are not able to sense from your eyes, ears, and you are not able to sense anything, then possibly you would not be able, your organization is not able to sense that kind of thing, your growth will not happen. That is for your external growth. For your internal growth, you need to develop your immune system. Your immune system has to be strong, and that comes from the culture. So these two areas, I think you need to focus very, very strongly.
Well, we have one final question now. We have time for one final question. And Srihari Undupa has asked this question. Hello, Commander. Very interesting concept of morality of profit. Thank you for your thoughts. Could you share examples of good purpose you have seen in private sector companies, which employees could relate or connect to their work and find inspiration from?
Okay. You said good culture, which employees have seen.
Purpose, good purpose you have seen in private companies.
You're talking about private companies or you're talking about a general organization for that matter?
Well, he has asked for a private sector company, but I guess we can take a good organization and refer to it.
Okay. I see, private sector, in any case, I have mentioned to you one example of Tata. Taken. The other which comes to my mind in an Indian company is Infosys. In fact, earlier this year, Mr. Anand Mahindra had written an article in the Times of India saying that he wants to have a very wider discussion on what is the purpose of the organization within the Mahindra group. So I think there is a lot of already a debate going on as to what should be the entire focus area. The purpose of the organization is always why we exist, why of the organization. Your existence defines the purpose of the organization, not what you do. What you do is something different. Why you exist has to be defined in that purpose of the organization. So I think many of these companies have started to relook in the entire concept of that purpose of the organization. Why we exist. Say, for example, Infosys, when I said that Infosys had defined certain values for which its founders possibly, you know, when the company got listed, I think in early, late 90s or maybe early 20s, there were a lot of news that even the driver of that company had become a millionaire because the Mr. Narayan Murthy and the entire people, they have very generously given the ESOP to a whole lot of employees. And they included the drivers also, the people who worked at that organization. And Mr. Vishal Sikka was brought in that company by, I would say, Mr. Narayan Murthy. He was with SAP, global head of operations and, you know, whatnot. He had a very high credentials. But certainly that culture which he had seen in SAP and the kind of culture which existed in Infosys was at variance. So although he might have been a global leader, he might have been a very, you know, well-respected and renowned person in his field, delivering good profit to the company. But the purpose for which the founders, they might have decided on certain purpose of that organization, this or based on which they had created that values system for that organization, they found it at variance and he had to be removed. The same you find it in the Tatas when the chairman of the Tata Sons was removed, that Mr. Sapurji's I'm forgetting his name. He was also removed. So you find that if in 2019, the US companies of 200 US major companies are deciding on what should be the purpose. So that inherently, I find that a lot of other companies have started to debate on that. The purpose of the organization, if you are able to exactly pinpoint, this is how I exist and this is what I exist for, then you can very easily translate it into the vision statement. So as I said, as far as the military is concerned, the purpose is the national aim. And what is the national aim? It is defined in the constitution. What is it, the rest of the constitution? It is defined in the preamble. So just follow that. Do whatever is as per that. Any amendment, the constitution is the entire purpose by which you have to decide your plans, policies, and objectives. It doesn't, there may be changes, amendments as we progress and as the society moves ahead. What is relevant 50 years might not be relevant now. You need to change it. But a certain guidelines already exist. The same way, the purpose needs to be defined by an individual organization. Why we exist? If that why is very well defined, then your vision statement can be defined. And as I said, maybe Tata's, the Infosys, Mahindra's have started to talk like that. And they might have conducted a lot of in-house programs on that to talk about that because it has come from the highest level. And it was a very big article which he had written in Times of India early this year.
Thank you so much. And Srihari did mention it was Cyrus Mistry.
Yes. Srihari Udupa, he has mentioned. Cyrus Mistry, yes. Thank you, Mr. Srihari Udupa, sir.
Thank you so much, sir. We are nearing our promised time. And it has been a lovely 90 minutes wherein we had very, very practical, relevant examples. And more importantly, bridges to the corporate world, which was quite enlightening. And I think these are all very easy to observe and to emulate in our day-to-day business. So once again, from NHRD Chennai chapter, we warmly thank you. And we wish we can host more sessions and get to hear from you more. We wish everybody here a very warm evening. Thank you, Mahesh, for referring Commander Sanjeev Raman to us. And signing out, wish you all a happy evening.
I would like to mention one last word. So all the people, I think I should have done it earlier because many people have already left. So I'll request the members of the Chennai chapter and all those who participated, please find time to buy and read my book and give your valuable comments on Amazon. And if there are any ways I can be associated with any kind of training and any kind of activity with any company, I would be very, very happy to be part of this. Thank you once again for giving me this opportunity. Thank you.
We are honored indeed, Commander. Thank you so much. Good evening, everybody. Have a great night.